Welcome, everybody. This is the City Commons Small Talk Roadmap for the State Conference. And one thing I've noticed, I give this presentation each year, and I noticed one thing that every year I look more and more forward to giving this presentation because we've got more and more focused and exciting things going on in the product. So I'm really looking forward to telling you guys about these things. First, I want to mention there are some other presentations. Dirk and Andreas will be talking about the new data daily implementation this afternoon, and it's a big upgrade for Object Studio and a lot of interesting stuff. I know the engineers are really excited to tell you about it. Les will be talking this afternoon about the history of internationalization, a brief history of internationalization, and how it relates to our project. So I hope you're able to attend those. And I'm going to be zipping pretty quickly through most of these slides, so I make sure to leave some time at the end. I have a couple short videos and a demonstration to try out on new folks. So these are basically the contents I'll be going through. So small talk for the long haul. I know most of the people here have chosen Smalltalk as a strategic solution. You're counting on it, and we want you to know that at SynCom we've got the same commitment. Particularly this conference where we're looking back at the amazing invention and the amazing things people did 30 years ago, and we love that, we respect that, but we are squarely focused on moving Smalltalk into the future and keeping it a viable, vibrant language for people to use now and in the future. It's really important to us. SynCom has a big commitment and backs Smalltalk. We sponsor events like this. We're actively advancing two commercial Smalltalk products. We work with customers to make sure that we're meeting and understanding their requirements for what they need in the product, not just what we want to give them, but we need to make sure that we're giving them what they need in order to be successful. We make a personal use version available so anybody can learn of modern high-performance Smalltalk. We employ directly and indirectly a large number of Smalltalkers. Just to say we're behind. We are fully behind and support Smalltalk. I'm the product manager and part of the product management team, and I try to do a lot of things to also improve our process and improve the viability of the product. So we've done things like make changes to the product releases, try longer, shorter cycles, see what works, what doesn't. Just because things are working okay doesn't mean we can't make them better. And we're really trying to do that. One of the big changes was we push out releases twice a year. We'd have a major release and a dot release. But the dot release used to be really the same size as the major release. And customers started telling me, it doesn't make sense. That's not what we expect. It's not what we want. And so several releases back, we made that change. We now have true maintenance releases where it is a fixed minor tweak, no major things thrown in all of a sudden. So if you move to a major version and now you want to port to a minor version, it's very easy to do. It's what people expect, and ask for, and what we're giving our customers. Focus much more on, like I mentioned, what are the requirements for our customers. I think somebody mentioned yesterday, hey, customers is the whole point. We agree. We've had much more focused releases, largely, again, paying attention to what our customers need. So we're here for the 30th anniversary of Smalltalk, and again, SynCom pays homage to all those involved with the creation. It's really a pretty amazing thing, and amazing the impact that Smalltalk and the groups at Xerox PARC had on modern computing. So much of it stems from what came there and what they had there in the mid-70s. And all this reminded me a little bit of a book I read when I was younger, a book about Jules Verne, the man who invented the future. And Jules Verne is known as the father of science fiction. So he dreamed up these great things, and that made me think, well, to me, here's the team, and this is just part of the team, I know, the team of science fact, They not only dreamed up these things, they did it. They implemented it. They, like Alan Kay always said, the best way to predict the future is to invent it. They did something about it. So that's an amazing accomplishment when you think about it. So if small talk was so wonderful, really did all these magical things and had such an influence, shouldn't we see that? And there's I think a lot of this point will be well understood by the crowd here, but particularly to people who are not familiar with small talk or the influence that it's had, it's a more powerful message. So if small talk has had all this influence, we should see it somewhere, right? Well, where might we see it? We can, probably all of us here can give lots and lots of examples, but one I would point out is, well, what's the largest company by capitalization in the world? Actually, I think they slipped back to number two, but anybody know?
Apple
Computer, sure. And this next slide is meant half tongue in cheek, half dead serious. Okay, so we definitely see an influence there. Now, in some ways, it doesn't match up well with the relatively closed systems, which in a way is the antithesis of what the intention of the Dynabook was. But lots of other ways, it's dead on. And we know that Steve Jobs visited Park, and one of the things that really struck him was the user interface and having a good user interface and how important that was. And of course, we know that there were tablets around for years, and they didn't take off until somebody did the interface really, really well in a really usable, attractive manner, and then it just exploded. And of course, we know the language underneath these, Objective-C, was heavily influenced by small talk. So there's one example of the influence of small talk. Now, so this was the 30th anniversary celebration. I was trying to think of, okay, what can I have as a theme for my talk? And I started thinking, 30th anniversary, okay, 30th. Well, what if this was a wedding anniversary? I was thinking, okay, what? I had to look it up, I had no idea. If it was a wedding anniversary, what would it be? And the answer is it's the pearl anniversary, which if you can see the background here, it's pearls. So that kind of gave me a little bit of a theme. I think, okay, we're saying our vows of appreciation for small talk. And this would be the third of the pearl anniversary. And the pearl anniversary reminded me of something else. If you saw my other talk, I mentioned it. Some years ago, I put together for our group and for our account managers, why small talk? Why would you want to use small talk? What's different? What's better? What's attractive about small talk? And made a list of things for our people to discuss when talking to new people that aren't familiar with it, why they might consider looking at it and using it, and what's the benefit. And Doug Rogers, our North American sales manager, looked at the list and said, Arden, those are the pearls of small talk. And that name stuck. We liked it. With the pearls theme, Jeremy was here, did a pearls theme in the pretty background you see here, so that stuck. It was a nice group collaboration. So back to the whole wedding theme. Got me thinking, okay, something old, something new. Anybody finish that?
Something borrowed,
something done. There's actually even a little more, but I'll enjoy the rest of that. Something about putting money in your shoe, but. So for this momentous occasion, we want to outfit small talk with something old, something new, something borrowed, something blue. So I wanted to, thought I'd we need to have a little icon for each and correlate these to some of the things and the changes in our product. And I started looking for pictures of old, and they weren't very attractive. I didn't want to put them here. I would much rather call any septuagenarians in the audience, folks in their 70s, I would rather call them classic or classy rather than old. And again, the pictures weren't pretty. So we'll call that classic. Something new, we've got a lot of number of new things that we've got, I'm going to tell you about. Something borrowed, open source. So we do a few things with open source. First, we recognize the the value and the impact, and it's a great framework, which is Seaside. So we basically, before each release, we get the latest version out of freeze time and integrate into the product, so it's easy to load and use within our Smalltalk products. Another open source framework was mentioned earlier this morning, Glorp, which we use heavily in the product, and we contribute heavily to. Most of the changes in the past few years have been by Syncommerce.
I just want to add something, if I could interrupt.
Sure.
Smalltalk is open source. We have to keep reminding people that the two first open source software packages, Smalltalk and Unix, were both commercial. So open source does not mean the same thing as free and open source.
Okay.
And in Smalltalk, it's by definition, you have the source to everything that's interesting.
Good point. So we contribute to the Glorp open source project. Some engineers at Syncom had a great idea about how to do a better streaming library for Smalltalk to get around some frustrations and difficulties they've had. So that created the Extremes project, and that was open source because we felt that the value was a higher value to us if it was accepted by the Smalltalk community rather than just trying to keep it proprietary. So I know that's been adopted by a number of other of the Smalltalk dialects and some really neat stuff. Something blue. Well, you know, one of our customers is considered blue, but I didn't want to go there. So our logos are blue and bluish. So it may be a stretch, but that's my story, and I'm sticking with it. So let me talk about the products. And one thing I'd like to discuss about the products is past, present, and future. When I talk about the past, I don't mean long past. I mean basically the last 2-3 years, just so you can kind of get the flavor of what's been happening in the product. Present, I'm talking about our releases this summer. Actually, both products are kind of in the final throes of QA right now. And future, I'll give some, talk at least a little bit about what some of the things that we're looking to do in the future. And if you guys have some ideas, I'm the product manager, please come talk to me. I live for this stuff. So if you've got ideas or have requirements, please let me know what they are. So both our products run on the foundation, which is basically the VM and core libraries originally from VisualWorks. So we invest heavily in the foundation so that both our products benefit from that. So a lot of the things I'm going to be talking about are things in the foundation and that our products benefit from. First, some years back, actually, when Alan Knight was up here last, what was a major part of, we did what I call sharpen the saw, and that's a Stephen Covey reference where he says two woodcutters are working, cutting down trees through a forest, and their saw is getting duller and duller. So he says, why don't you stop and sharpen your saw? And they're like, we can't, we're behind schedule. And no, sometimes you need to slow down, stop, and take care of your tooling to make it better. Otherwise, things are just going to eventually grind to a halt. So we did a number of things where we basically studied agile software development and made a number of real changes in the way we develop software, which are still with us today, including some regular stand-up calls, automated tests built in with our weekly builds for the product. So it was good to take that time and reflect and improve things. Some things from the foundation recent past, we are fully, all our VMs are now Unicode. We had some initial 64-bit VMs, which were not up to the standard of our 32-bit VMs, so we invested in those so those would be truly usable by our customers. Microsoft Windows does things a little bit differently than most of the other operating systems, so it took a little longer, but we came up with a Windows 64-bit VM and image. Improvements in garbage collection. We have atomic loading, which solves some subset of problems of load sequencing. And delay alternative, because as operating systems evolve, our delays in certain contexts wouldn't work the way people wanted them to, so we have an alternative implementation to solve some of those things. One of the things that we did, and it's a point that's really important to me, is that we look at Store, and our customers use Store as something very, very heavily, and we had a whole list of things of improvements that we wanted to make. So I worked with engineering, and we sat down with them and said, okay, how are we going to get from where we are now to where we want to get to? And we can just keep adding on things, but it might be too brittle and not the best way. So we decided we need to invest in shoring up the foundation of the Store product. Something you mentioned a day or two ago, they called it Store, and that's Store on Glory. And so Store was completely revamped. It's taken several cycles, but we've invested. Our interest is in what's best for the long term for our customers, and for the viability of our products. So if we do this, and you'll see another example of this type of investment in the product. So Store is completely revamped. There's new Store browsers also, new Store garbage collection. We have a new merge engine, new comparison tool, a bunch of changes. I mentioned earlier, the Seaside with the latest greatest in each release for easy loading and usage by our customers. It's a great framework. One of the problems we ran into when one of our customers wanted to export our product to another country, and we started filling out the basic paperwork to do that, and they said, hold on, you have encryption? You have encryption in your product. Okay, well we need to have a conversation about that. It's like, question, how long can your keys be? What do you restrict your keys to? And I think the answer went out of the room. Sorry, little letter. We don't restrict our keys. Oh, you basically get a very high level classification and a high level of restriction as to where you can export your software to. So, being the clever guys that we are, we figure, well, we know how to fix that. We do all the encryption in Smalltalk right now. So we'll just use external libraries, and we'll just give you an API to them and use those external libraries and problem solved, right? That's what we thought. But we went back and they said, okay, we pulled out all the source code for encryption. We're just using these external things. Now what's our classification? And they said, same thing. And we were all, frankly, a little surprised by that. So since it wasn't going to make a difference, we said, well, now we have two great solutions for our customers. Let's give them both. It's not going to make a difference. I want our customers to have all the options that we can offer. So we have an option for external, and you know, some of those are assembly coded for high performance. So if you're doing massive encryption, some of those external libraries are probably where you want to go. At present, some changes that we have in the foundation, enhancements to time, timestamp. With some of the cryptography, if you use an external solution and you deploy an application and there's no external solution there, it will fall back to internal encryption. At present, I mentioned we've made some performance improvements in the VM in the past. Also in our current release, we've reduced the overhead by making a faster scavenge of particularly of fixed and large objects, and a smaller, faster compactor. So we're not just saying, this is good enough, we'll leave it alone. We are actively trying to improve all areas of the product. Store, we continue to improve. We have one step merge and publish, with undo coming out. Our store repository creation, that's if you're starting from scratch, creating a store repository. We basically redid that script. We had a couple issues with it, so we basically revamped that and made it much better. We've got performance improvements in it, largely by going through the database queries and improving those, but we have a number of improvements that we still have on the books and are working on right now. Our VisualWorks product is cross-platform, and one of the important platforms for both our products is the web. So we want to make sure that people have the best options that we can give them for doing any work on the web. So we have a new web server. It's called Sue, and the capital S at the end is because it uses the Extremes framework. So what was the goal of Sue? Basically building a server using Extremes and making it as simple, scalable, and as performant as we can make it. Those are the goals of the new Sue server. So we have in this release, in preview, the new Sue server works with HTTP, HTTPS, the Net or Extremes frameworks, and we've rehosted C-sided web services to use this new server. So you can start using it, you can start experimenting with it, giving us feedback right now. It's pretty stable. So we recommend that you at least look at moving your web apps to the new Sue server. It's our one way forward rather than having a scattering of solutions. We want to provide one way that's superior to all our other old existing ways. Here's just a list of some of the things that it does. We'll go into that right now. Okay, so we're giving you a modern web server. What about modern web apps? 2 years ago, if you attended the conference in Las Vegas, one of the keynote speakers was Avi Bryan. You all know that Avi's one of the creators of Seaside, which, again, is a great framework. We love it. And Avi discussed, he said, you know, if I were starting this all over right now with all the new technology that's here now that wasn't here when I started Seaside, here's how we do it. And that's basically, we have a new web application framework that's basically what Avi described at that conference. It's called AppX, and it's in preview. Again, capitalized at the end. It uses Extremes. And what does it do? How does it work? Well, it's modern. It uses HTML5, JavaScript, AJAX, JSON, XHR. And the basic idea is we're not trying to replicate or redo or integrate every latest, greatest invention for the client end, the web, the client web end. We're letting you use whatever you want in that and supporting it as best we can. So you can use any JavaScript library. We don't need to integrate it in. You can just start using it immediately. We do expected things like automatic session management. We manage both the Smalltalk and JavaScript code in our product, and we also parse the JavaScript and understand it so you can get senders and implementers, and it understands the literals to make it usable and give you some tools in that area. It's also very lightweight and flexible, and it uses Sue. And I want to give you a demonstration of this at the end, which is what I'm going to do through. So our brand new AppX and Sue solutions, it's, you know, we're really excited about this and the options that it gives our customers for doing modern things and keeping Smalltalk involved in any modern web solutions. I always like to joke, I joked before, that polycephaly is what you get when your engineers name the product. And we've actually named Polycephaly 2, the second version of that. Latest greatest is now called Matrix, and again with capital X, you know the theme, it uses Extremes. A Matrix not only lets you leverage a multi-core processor, also allows you to use other computers on your grid. So it's a great and often very easy way to get a big boost in throughput in your applications. If that might work for you, I highly recommend you take a look at it. It's one of my favorite things. In the future, some store improvements that we're working on right now, reducing memory allocation, improving, some of our customers. Well, we have a number of customers that we're working with who use store in atypical but valid ways, and they're pushing it to the limits and telling us, hey, can you do anything about this, using it in this context? So some of those things like they want to use one source code management system, they want to use store, and they want to attach lots of files. And comparing those, it can work slowly, so we're improving how that works in a number of algorithms. We made a lot of improvements in the database queries to improve performance there, but there's not a number of places where we can make significant improvements, and we are working on that. So what else is coming in the future? Well, the previews that I talked about, but they're really usable now. We want to do lots more with them. And by the way, one of the things I left out to tell you about Apex. So Apex lets you use JavaScript on the front end, but also one of the original goals is, hey, if the customers want to use Amber or Dart, those are absolutely viable and should work great in this context and with our Apex solution. That's an important thing I want to tell you about. Object Studio, I'll get into the specific products briefly here. Object Studio, how do we talk about Object Studio? We call it the business analyst thinking tool, where a developer and a business analyst can sit down and using the tools that are unique to this, the modeling and mapping tool, they basically sketch out and it will generate a whole Smalltalk-based framework, which then you can map your domain objects to the database using the mapping tool. So it lets you build a flesh out a structure and get up and running very quickly. And again, a business analyst and a developer can sit down and kind of get on the same page and both be invested in. And where people use that, they find that this works great. It also does bidirectional, supports bidirectional development. So you can change it up at the top end, at the specification, or down at the implementation level, and it's reflected at the other end, which is pretty tricky to do it. And most products like this don't do that. We call that round-trip engineering. So we are continuing to upgrade and improve this product. Some of the things in the recent past, we moved it to the foundation so we can put all the improvements into one area and everybody benefits. New logos and icons, again, what makes us unique, especially is the modeling and mapping tools, really important. We always have changes and improvements for those. Moving to the compilers, we were the first Smalltalk that was Vista certified, then Windows 7, and soon Windows 8, logo compatibility. At present, all those improvements you saw in the foundation, it gets those. Better font integration, we can use all the different ways of using fonts now. In general, one of the major themes is where things are in C, kind of black box, we're moving those into Smalltalk, so those areas are now accessible and customizable by customers who want access to those areas to do things, to, you know, make changes and do things exactly how they want their applications to work. And always lots of fixes and refinements with each release. Always investing, current more investments and improvements in the modeling tool. This release, improving the class imports and the help tools, better table creation with the mapping tool. The mapping tool, one of the recent releases moved to, it operates on top of Glorp, so we use that in a number of places for the product. And we also have a number of database improvements each release. Here are the ones for the upcoming release. And what you'll hear about later today is some of the new GUI work, and some of that is already in this release. Things like progress bar and marquee dialog you can now use easily within the product. And Dirk and Andreas will be telling you all about the new things that you can do and how easy it is to use. It's a big upgrade, the new GUI work. So the big thing to tell you in the upcoming release, the new GUI preview, and also each product before had a separate COM. We said, well, which one is most advanced? And the foundation one was advanced, and we are moving both products to a shared COM. So all of our customers get the best of what we can offer, and we're also working on making it easy to use within the context of Object Studio. So it's easy for our customers to port and gain the new accessibility to the new features. So in the future, the new GUI work will be finalized, as well as the new COM work. And again, every release, all the foundation benefits we get. Okay, just checking my time. VisualWorks. So some of the things that changed in the past with VisualWorks, the VisualWorks launcher. It always bothered me, particularly on Windows and Mac, we'd have this nice icon that was largely, it was pretty, but it was largely a waste. It would start up visual.im. And if you came back to that, it wouldn't bring you back to the image that you created before. It would give you another visual.im. And we do better. What it does now on Windows and Mac is it opens up a project launcher and allows you to create a project. So you can basically name the project and it creates an image with that name. So what it does is it's really two things. This really addresses helping newbies become familiar with this because they don't have to trip over themselves before they learn that, okay, what you need to do is start visual.im, rename it, and now you have to go find it to launch it in the future. When you go back to VisualWorks Launcher, it gives you a list of your images, your projects, and you can launch them from right there. So it makes it easier for new people that want to try Smalltalk, makes them more comfortable, it looks more familiar. And it also actually stores your images on the proper place, the read-write place where Microsoft and Apple say that you should put them. So it satisfies a number of things. And of course, if you've been using it for years, you can go there, get a list of your things and launch them from there, or you can ignore it. It won't get in your way. So I think it's a nice solution and a better use of that resource. In the past, we've completely revamped COM. We have a 64-bit version of COM. We've integrated ActiveX pieces into VisualWorks, where you can put an ActiveX component, embed them in your Windows. Recently, Microsoft has changed their C++ library that you would either need to install, and if you're deploying an application, some of our customers were asking, well, we'd like the option of having that linked together so we don't have to worry about that thing that Microsoft changed. So that's something we've delivered. We have faster arithmetic on our big Endian platforms. We've made more changes to our garbage collection, done a number of compiler upgrades. In the Spark, we're using the new V8 instruction set. Newer. I mentioned before that we invested in store over a long period of time. And likewise, we had another area. I want to start addressing some other major areas and upgrading things in the product. So one of those areas is people use the product, and we have all kinds of really cool goodies in the product for doing things like auto completion, highlighting, and a bunch of other things that you can do in your browsers. But I started getting feedback from customers and new people looking at it. Well, that's all fine and well, but I really don't want to go hunt for those things. Those kinds of things should be built into the product. So we sat down with engineering and said, how are we going to get there? What's the best way? And they said, well, you know what? The text editor, which has probably been there for 25 plus years and has withstood the test of time, but things have changed a lot over those almost three decades. So they said, we really should look at revamping text editor. And that's what we've been doing. We basically have invested in coming up with a completely new text editor that solves the shortcomings that we saw in the old one and supports all the modern things that we want to do. And it's a significant upgrade. And that will be in preview in this release, and it's going to have a lot of impact on the product. I'm going to show you at the end here, I'm going to show you a very short video of some of the capabilities of what it can do. With this release, we'll have three text2-based widgets that you can start using right now if you have the need for those things. And like I said, we'll do some neat things. The three widgets are the input editor, document editor, and document view. So some things that text2 can do that the current text cannot. Here are some things, and there'll be more visible in the video. What else have we got? GUI changes. Skins, I mentioned in my other talk, skins is something I think is really neat. It kind of helps solve the age-old problem of what's better, native widgets or emulated widgets? And there's pros and cons to either. What skins does, it says, okay, I'm going to try to give you the best of both worlds, in a sense. And that you have a customizable widget that you can make, sing, dance, do anything you want, you can customize it. Yet the rendering is actually done by the host operating system. So on Windows and Mac, the rendering is actually truly done by the operating system capabilities. So that's in preview. I'll also show you a short video on that. Keyboard handling is being overhauled. New hotkey system. Color spectrum consolidation and a list of improvements for the OS X operating system. What about the future? Well, some of these previews, like Text 2, will be fully supported, and there's a whole lot of areas in the product, basically throughout the whole IDE, through lots of areas where Text 2 is going to be integrated. So it'll be a fairly major upgrade, and with some other ideas, and this is, I mentioned earlier, I really get more and more excited each year to give this presentation about what we're doing, because I look at the current planning we're doing right now, and I just want to tell you, buckle your seatbelts. It's accelerating. We've got lots of new things, and including things like Text 2, give us the ability to do lots more on top of that. So it's investing in some foundational pieces that give us a lot of ability to really scale up with some interesting things in the future. Here's just a contact slide, and again, if you have any great ideas or requirements for your business, I want to hear about it. I want to hear what you think about our products and what's important to you. And let me know if any of these things are really useful, because I prioritize the work that gets done. So please talk to me if you have any input. What I want to do now is show you some video. And the interesting thing here was, I asked one of the engineers who worked on Text 2, I said, give me a 3 to 7 minute video. And he said, okay. And he came back 2 days later and he says, it's uploading, it'll take a couple hours. A couple hours? How big is it? He goes, how long is this video? He said, oh, it's about 33 minutes. Why? He said, Arden, there was just too many great things, and I needed to make it that long. I really appreciate it. I love having that kind of problem. And I really appreciate the way it was telling me. I said, that's awesome, but just give me, make it 5 minutes, and just go bang, bang, bang through the what things that you think are most interesting. And he did that. I have both versions now.
Welcome to a short introduction on Text 2. I'm going to rapidly show you a whole bunch of features that are new to Text 2 over the original text in VisualWorks. We have multiple kinds of alignments, all the standard ones, and it's also pluggable if you want to add your own. Obviously, left alignment, right alignment, center alignment, and justify. It's also multilingual with bidirectional content. So if you are right to left content, you will, in fact, get the alignments flipped. So the left alignment actually becomes right, the right alignment becomes left. Lots and lots of colors! There are many built-in adornments, and it's also pluggable to add new kinds of adornments as required. For example, underline, double underline, jagged underline. It's also strike-through, overline, shadows. We can also specify a color for the adornment, like so. A line of content can have multiple font heights, such as this line here, where we go from 32 down to tiny little 4. different kinds of fonts from Helvetica to Arial to Sans, and also share the line with images, such as these ones here, which also adjust the line height. Therefore, we also have vertical alignment. Here is the bottom of the line, the baseline, and the top. The baseline is the shared baseline between all the different fonts. Here it is more dramatic, bottom, baseline, and top. And also with the images, smaller image shared with a bigger image on the same line. Individual content can have a mixture of these styles, an underline in this case, blue coloring, but also annotations. Is this really a hyperlink? Click to find out. I am a hyperlink. Not only can we include images in the document, but also lists. Here is an example of three different types of lists, starting with bulleted lists, going to Roman numeral lists, and into katakana lists. Here we can see an example of sub-content on the same paragraph. This is inserted with a Shift-Enter, as opposed to an Enter. We can also use Tab at the start of the line to control the depth of an item, like so. Text2 supports multilingual content with bidirectional content. Here we have a document that contains English, Latin language, as well as Hebrew and Arabic. Here we have Arabic Hebrew and English mixed together on the same line. Watch as the selection moves between two different content directions. The Hebrew in this case is right to left content, while the English is left to right. We also have the ability to override the direction of content. Here we have said that this English word is actually right to left, and so it goes backwards. The same is true of this Hebrew word here, which says Hebrew. The regular word here from right to left is then turned into the opposite direction inside these brackets. Here you can see that English followed by 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, when put into the Arabic, is still 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, followed by the Arabic word. So right to left, but then the numbering system is still left to right. This is some of the interesting capabilities here. Also, we have the ability to specify the default direction of a paragraph. Here, it deduced that the Hebrew was right to left content, but we can force that paragraph to take a different direction, in this case, left to right. Here are some bonus settings that this widget comes with, such as drawing line numbers, which isn't so useful for Smalltalk programming, but is useful for other applications. Line striping, a commonly requested feature that allows even in odd lines to have different background colors. And showing hidden characters, such as new lines, here in the light green, and tabs, here in the light green here. We can also control whether the selection is drawn, or whether the input cursor is gone. Hidden cursor. Let's try showing the cursor, but hiding selection. We'll select this entire section and delete it. And there we go, we never saw the actual selection. We also have read-only mode, and we can also turn off word wrapping. Here is a quick example of some Smalltalk coding that has syntax highlighting. We've actually borrowed this from the existing syntax highlighter and applied it using text2 styles. Here we have an assortment of input editors. These are like input fields, except using new text2. In this particular example, we have a default content that appears whenever we have no content in here. That's useful for things like search boxes or other such input fields that you wish to prompt users about. Here we have regular input field filtering, which limits us to, in this case, 10 characters only. And finally, we also have passwords, which makes sure that the content is always displayed as stars. These new widgets can be added from the UI Painter. Here we have a document view for read-only documents, a document editor for editing documents, and a input editor for single line input